Hello, my name is KB Carle, and today I'll be reading my story published in Runaway, an anthology entitled Sever, and it's part of my Grim Reaper series, a series of stories told from the point of view of a Grim Reaper. Sever. I hang around for the after. Aaron sees the scars of the women moving throughout the train station as thin strips of duct tape. The same scars she hides beneath her oversized sweater. She rolls her black socks down to pick at the scabs. The woman at the information desk has strips of duct tape over her hands, passes a train schedule to an elderly woman who has duct tape forming small X's along her back, disappearing within the green dress she wears. A woman who runs her fingers through the hair of a sleeping man, his head resting on her lap, has duct tape wrapped around her feet, stretching up to her ankles. A woman with duct tape across her mouth escorts her daughter with duct tape knees into the bathroom. Aaron's husband believed everything could be fixed with duct tape. However, the tongue drying out in her pocket needs water from either the fountain outside or the bathroom. Aaron hasn't decided yet. As a Reaper, I can't help her decide. Not that she would hear my opinion if I spoke it out loud. Another woman waits for her husband, who is having a warring conversation between his cell phone and anyone who dares to shake their head at him. This woman, with duct tape around her eyes, sits on the fountain's edge, drags her finger over the water's surface, causing minor collisions that no one feels but her. If Aaron chooses the fountain, she would have to explain the tongue. At least, I think so, though I don't know what it's like to have a tongue, or to have someone steal it from me. Aaron grabs her suitcase, feels the weight of her life packed inside, notices how easily she can spin with it in her grasp, free to release it and injure others, free to hold everything she has left, everything she could snatch without thinking, close to her chest, over her shoulder, in front of her face. For now, she holds the suitcase at her side and walks to the nearest bathroom. Inside, the mother with the duct tape over her mouth waits outside a bathroom stall. Her cheeks puff when she notices Aaron and, maybe me too. I like to think she's smiling at one or both of us. Aaron doesn't feel the same, grip tightening around the tongue. The mother knocks on the door of the bathroom stall. Almost! Is it weird to rinse a severed tongue in a public bathroom? Is it worse to do it in front of a small child? The little girl, instead of doing what humans do in bathrooms, is making toilet paper bows and tying them in her hair. However, toilet paper is a weak material, as Aaron discovers in the stall next door, unable to unroll enough sheets to wrap the tongue and slip it into her suitcase between her last-minute collection of baggy sweatshirts with chewed-off cuffs, a roll of duct tape, and scissors in a Ziploc bag with blood smeared on the inside. Duct tape can't fix everything. The girl comes out of the stall at the same time as Aaron, both losers in war against single-ply toilet paper. The little girl soaks what remains of her tissue ribbons with tears, and her mother pats her head in a way that moves the girl towards the door. I remove my hood, pack my skull, wonder what a mother's touch feels like. Aaron kneels in front of the girl before they leave, and for a moment, I think she's going to give the child the tongue as a parting gift. Instead, she angles her suitcase so neither mother or daughter can see inside and pulls out her roll of duct tape. While she works, Aaron thinks about the husband she left behind on the kitchen floor, how he gazed at her, body lurching from the shock or struggle of trying to gasp for air, but having blood seep from his throat at the same time. I missed all the screaming, the angry exchange that probably led to him grabbing her wrist. I phased through the wall just as she grabbed a kitchen knife and, foolishly, I raised my hands. She held it pointed between my ribcage before she turned away, slashing the air between her and her husband until he decided to come closer. Until she decided to keep the knife moving even when an easy flick of the wrist became a jagged pull. Until she decided she couldn't stop. Or refused to. Erin uses her teeth to tear into the duct tape because they are strong after years of barring her words. Her hands steady because they are the same hands that reached for her husband's wallet when his body stilled. Hands that collect the remains of an unwanted life and threw the pieces into a suitcase. Same hands that used the money she found to buy a ticket to a place she doesn't know but is hours away from him, from this final duct tape solution. Erin laughs, is surprised by the feel of it expanding in her throat. She sticks the duct tape bow on the girl's forehead, which is very unflattering. The girl thinks so too and decides to transform the gift into a bow tie. She thanks Erin, and I think the girl's mother would too if she could. Once they leave, Erin places what's left of the duct tape in her suitcase, turns on the hot water, waits for the steam to appear. She removes the tongue from her pocket, watches the taste buds rise. She exits the bathroom, tongue tucked in her pocket again, counting her steps to the train. I follow her until I can't, left floating above train tracks. She never looks back. Thank you for listening, and stay safe out there.